Shalom Rastafari. This will be kind of like a history 101, well, actually like a history 110, the true history of the United States of America, particularly concerning the Civil War. We thought about this and we just have to say something. Okay, so, you know, basically children throughout the nation recognized as the United States of America are being lied to on a daily basis concerning the Civil War. To be more specific, there has been spread this rumor, or in some cases it's an attempt, whether consciously or unconsciously, to kind of mislead the average U.S. citizen into make believing that the purpose for the Civil War was somehow that we as a nation might attain liberation for the Hebrew Israelite slave. And so that's not true. The purpose of the Civil War has nothing to do with liberating the Hebrew slaves. In reality, and we don't want to go into details, if we could just put it in simple terms, there were at that time obvious differences between the North and the South. The North wasn't really doing much, and it had to, you know, bear witness to the South coming up in many different types of ways and forms. You know, the South owning large lands that brought forth abundant, different kinds of agricultural goods and stuff like that. You know, they were making money. They were making a lot of money and, becoming efficient at not spending money, you know, bringing in Hebrew Israelites as forced labor. We call it slavery. And so the North, basically the North is kind of hating on the South. So we could say this is a case of Ha-Shaytan against Wa-Shaytan, and eventually bringing about the destruction, which we can bear witness to this day today. Now, but we have to do away with this idea that's being taught throughout schools within the U.S. that the Civil War, that the purpose for the Civil War was in fact to liberate the Hebrew Israelite from slavery, which is completely false. If it resulted in such a way, kind of, even let's not make this complicated, right? But let's pretend that the Hebrew Israelite did in fact become liberated post Civil War. If ever that became a part of the plan, or just, you know, as a result, thus concluded in somewhat of a liberation of Hebrew Israelites, it was not done out of the loving spirited northerners. You know what I'm saying? It's kind of like it wasn't a good an act of love in the spirit of Christ, you know, if ones could receive that. It was, they had no other option. It's like the North had their backs against the wall, and they figured that we assume that they knew that this would bring about their own destruction, but nonetheless, due to the situation the North was confronted with, then they had to, this was their only way. Like in many other cases, it's always having to depend and scavenge off of the efforts of other peoples to get their own, you know, acts together, you could say. Testimony to that would be how without the, you know, Native American, pilgrims would have never made it that that far, or that, you know, they probably would have starved or something, you know. And we could see another case in which the Hebrew Israelite built this country for the, in some kind of way, for the greatness that it is. And so let us return to the topic. These people, so likewise, these northerners figured, hey, well, we got no other option. If we can manipulate these people to fight for us like they've done in every other situation, then you know, we could we surely will be blessed with a victory. And so that's what turned out to be. Abraham Lincoln at the time, he himself quoted in many different documents and evidences in many different ways, shapes and forms, whether it be videos or documentations, actual newspaper clippings and stuff like that. He himself said that his goal was to preserve the Union, and if that could be achieved without liberating a single Hebrew, then so it would be. But you know, push comes to shove, they had no other option. Now, why did it come about? Well, like we made mention, the South was coming up, making money. The North is not doing well. They're just there, right? And so the Northerners, they become a little more political, we could say. They become, acting clever, becoming more clever and finding out ways to kind of impose taxes upon the South and implement these ideas that your goods have to become insured. And so the North resulted into transforming itself into this so-called financial the whole business, I mean, excuse me, the whole insurance industry, and that whole, you know, theft that still goes on to this very day. To take a piece of the action without putting in any work, just basically through means of extortion, you know, taking from the Southerners. Not like the Southerners were legit in the ways in which they obtained their profits, right? But nonetheless, the Southerners, you know, figured, you know, we're united, we got all the money, we got weapons, we got power, we got strength, you know, we don't have to put up with this, you know. So and we're sure that in more, you know, I guess in a more so-called intelligent manner, they would eventually break it down in this form. Northerners, it's been cool, you know, it's been quite a ride, but we're just gonna take off now, and we don't gotta be putting up with this BS that y'all be implementing on I and I. And so, you know, that's it. We're taking off, we're doing our own thing, but cool, you know, no hard feelings. But of course the North, you know, with abundant hard feelings, so they figured we have to force these individuals to continue amongst us. If not, what are we going to do? You know, we can't even depend on ourselves to do anything. Thus, you know, the whole bringing about Hebrew Israelites to do all the work for them. And so basically it's what we want to bring forth, you know. Another detail, small matter before we conclude, is we've noticed that history teachers, so-called, them pretending to be, they like to make it seem like all this just happened, you know, a few plantation owners, and they're just, you know, waking up at the woman's cooking breakfast, or you know, that whole supposed family early morning scenario, and as if a husband looked out the window and said, "Oh gosh, honey, what are all these Hebrew Israelites doing on our plantation, you know, working working the land, you know, willingly?" That's the way we've noticed that the so-called professors and teachers like to make it seem as if that's the way it came about, and that's completely false, you know. And the way things are going in a world where people are either schizophrenic or just slightly below the line of being able to distinguish reality from fantasy, you know, it's necessary that we put this out, this message, that we may reach those that are still within reaching ability, capacity, you know. And so we bring this truth forth. So once again, we conclude by making mention that the Civil War, the purpose for the Civil War, its original intention had nothing to do with the liberation of Hebrew Israelites. That came about because it was the only way, you know. They had to get Josh people on their side, that they may be blessed, or kind of like just just rub off some of the Jah children blessing, you know. So, and before we conclude, excuse me, spoke too soon, right? But we'd like to add another thing. A lot of people might bring forth evidence, this, evidence, that. Well, we know how lies are continually being made manifest in different ways and forms that we know not, for we don't deal with lies, right? The biggest evidence, and this will be impossible to counter for those that might not agree with this message, is people can say whatever, they can write whatever on documents, they can you know, pretend whatever, but the actions of a man speak louder than all of that, you know. And so, just, you know, to reflect on the happenings, if in purity and honesty, if wholly any individuals were aiming to liberate a Hebrew slave, it would not take a civil war. And, you know, let's even give them that much. Let's say that it did require a civil war. The proceedings, the actions of certain individuals post-war, post-civil war, would not be what we find in truth, in the memory of the experience, even the history books, and God as a witness. You know, it doesn't matter what they say or pretend. Just look at the behavior after the Civil War. That is not a behavior of people so-called fighting for the liberation of another people. It shouldn't even get to the point where there's fighting for liberation when we are all, you know, born free. But, you know, if things got to that point, okay. So we know why in its fullness, and you know, but that's a whole different story. But nonetheless, all right. So let's say the Civil War was fought, then the actions of the individual so-called fighting for liberation of certain people, in this case the Hebrew Israelites, their actions would not be as those which are clearly known. You know, it's that simple. There's no way of disproving this. I mean, even to this very day, the racism and the sense of superiority amongst some individuals continues. That is not a people that fought for the liberation of the Hebrew Israelite, you know. So I think that's probably like the strongest argument that we could bring forth. And anyways, it wouldn't take a civil war. If you honestly wanted to fight for the liberation of a people, you set them free and you respect them and you treat them as an equal. You know, you don't this whole civil rights and all that, if what they claim was true, there would not have to be any of this. But the fact that there is still to this very day a movement in which Jah's people continue trying to you know, to reach a state of equality with the downpressor, is testimony to their false, you know, so-called purposes. And so that's pretty much all we got to say. So Shalom Rast Eferi.